The Great Lakes Inventory and Monitoring Network provides long-term monitoring of critical natural resources in 9 national park units that cover 1 million acres, extending from the boreal forests of northern Minnesota to the sand dunes of southern Lake Michigan. Throughout the network, thousands of annual visitors are able to take recreational advantage of hundreds of inland lakes and portions of 2 major rivers. While most of these are clean and provide safe water, we see an increasing number of human-made chemicals reaching our region and parks.
Environmental contaminants are a huge issue. There's about 85,000 chemicals in the environment today, and approximately 2,000 get introduced every year to the market. And there's certain contaminants that are extremely dangerous. They're called the persistent bioaccumulative and toxic contaminants. So we are monitoring a small set of contaminants that are known to be toxic and that are persistent in the environment.
Since 2006, the Great Lakes I&M Network has been monitoring 6 different groups of chemicals: 2 heavy metals, mercury and lead, 2 legacy or banned contaminants, DDT, which was banned from use in the U.S. in 1972, and its derivatives, DDE and DDD, and PCBs, which were banned in the U.S. in 1976. And 2 are emerging contaminants, brominated flame retardants and perfluorinated contaminants, used for stain-resistant and water-resistant chemicals. These chemicals come from a variety of sources, such as power generation, to household products, and industrial waste disposal. There are numerous ways to monitor these contaminants. We chose to use the bald eagle.
Bald eagles are good sentinel species for monitoring environmental contaminants. They're on top of the aquatic food web. Their nestlings get fed from a site that's a local environment where we can get a feeling for how much contamination there is locally. And they accumulate contaminants throughout the food web. So they can get contaminants 10 million times more concentrated than the water around them.
We are currently monitoring bald eagles in 3 locations: the Mississippi National River and Recreation Area, the St. Croix National Scenic Riverway, and the Apostle Island National Lakeshore. The monitoring involves climbing up to eagle nests. Hand capturing 5 to 9 week old nestlings and bringing them to the ground.
Let me hand you these guys first.
Once on the ground, we take samples of the breast feathers to measure heavy metals. And then we take a blood sample to test for the organic contaminants. We also take measurements to determine the sex and age of the bird and its overall health. Then we place the nestlings back in the nest. The blood samples are sent into the analytical laboratory where the levels of environmental contaminants are measured. What have we discovered? Thanks to the Clean Air and Clean Water Acts, mostly good news. Mercury has declined, but it appears to be increasing again, and we found it to be particularly high on the upper St. Croix River. Lead has declined, but even low levels are of concern. We found consistently high levels in one area on the Mississippi River, and evidence of acute poisonings in other scattered locations. PCBs and DDT have declined, though DDE, the derivative of DDT that caused eggshell thinning in the early and mid-1900s, is still at high levels in some eagle nestlings on Lake Superior and on the Mississippi River. Brominated flame retardants and water and stain-resistant chemicals are particularly high in more populated areas and on Lake Superior. We monitor only a small number of these chemicals. Some of them are declining, but others are increasing, and there are many more that we are unable to monitor due to the high cost of analysis. While the good news is heartening, it is critical that we continue monitoring these persistent contaminants, not only to track their effects on wildlife, but to also accurately inventory the types of contaminants out in the environment that can affect humans. The information collected in our monitoring projects is used for both public education and to provide data to regulators and researchers. If you are interested in learning more, we provide a variety of technical reports, briefs, and science papers on the Great Lakes Network site.